morning comes, till the morning comes, till the morning comes. I'm only waiting till the morning comes, till the morning comes, till the morning comes.
The end of the 60s marked the end of an era for Neil Young. After exploring several musical ventures throughout the decade, the young Canadian was about to settle into one of the most prolific periods of his career, as he sowed the seeds of a solo career and became part of the folk rock supergroup Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young. The dawn of the 70s would reveal a new cultural landscape, disillusioned by the hippie collectivism of the late 60s and imbued with a melancholic atmosphere in the wake of failed dreams. Young's third solo full-length mirrored this febrile atmosphere, drawing its themes from a fictional unreleased screenplay and mining his inner state of turmoil after the disbandment of Buffalo Springfield. The album would defy critical scrutiny to become one of the defining records of both Young's career and of the 1970s. It was a culmination of all that had come before and a premonition of what would follow. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and on this edition of Classic Album Sundays Worldwide, I'll be taking an in-depth look at Neil Young's After the Gold Rush.
Sailing hardships through broken harbors, out on the waves in the night. Still a searcher must ride the dark.
Tell Me Why, from Neil Young's After the Gold Rush, released in 1970. But let's back up 7 years, when Young began his professional music career in Winnipeg, the capital and largest city of Canada's Manitoba province. He left high school early to focus on music full-time, and after playing in a series of short-lived collectives, he formed his first steady band in 1963 with friend and future collaborator Ken Coblin, called the Squires. Although the band were primarily a live entity with few recordings made during their brief lifespan, their performances at clubs such as the Flamingo and Fort William brought Young into contact with a series of influential figures, including Stephen Stills and Joni Mitchell. Young adapted well to new situations and new collaborations. He spent his childhood traveling between temporary homes across Canada and America due to strained family relationships. This prepared him for the life of a freewheeling musician, his only constant being a passion for the rock and roll of Fats Domino, Chuck Berry, and Link Wray. During the mid-60s, Young moved around the country playing in local clubs and bars, whilst briefly taking up positions in bands such as the Rick James-fronted Mina Birds.
Darling, with a love that's so strong and so fine, nothing in this whole wide world could ever make me change my mind.
It's my time.
I say, it's my time, baby.
Don't care what you say.
I really don't care what you say.
It's my time.
I say, it's my time. I'm gonna love you anyway. Yes, I said I'm gonna love you anyway.
No one else could ever love you more.
I'm gonna show that little heart of yours that I'm the one you've been searching for. Hey,
it's my time.
I said that it's my time.
I don't care what you say.
I don't care what you say, baby.
It's my time.
I said that it's my time. I'm gonna love you anyway. Every day.
Hard to believe now, but Rick James and Neil Young were once in the same band, the Mina Birds, with It's My Time. The group fell apart after James was arrested for being AWOL from the Navy, so Young and bassist Bruce Palmer decided to leave Canada for Los Angeles and pawn the band's equipment and use the cash to buy a Pontiac hearse. In Los Angeles, another chance encounter with Stephen Stills on Sunset Boulevard saw the pair resolve to create a brand new group of their own. They formed Buffalo Springfield with Palmer and drummer Dewey Martin in 1966 and came up with their own idiosyncratic sound that brought together a variety of influences from psychedelia, country, and rock. Their self-titled debut proved instantly popular amongst fans and critics, and the band were credited with solidifying the folk rock genre. They also had a hit with the Stills-fronted single For What It's Worth, a topical song written in response to the Sunset Strip curfew riots, which saw violent clashes between police and young people. As promising as the band seemed to be, it was not destined to last. Palmer had the extreme misfortune of being arrested and deported not once but twice for marijuana possession. And Young and Stills jostled for control over the band's songwriting. until their former's waning interest in the group led to David Crosby of the Byrds being drafted in as an occasional replacement. The original lineup finally caved in after the release of the band's second album, Buffalo Springfield Again, and their final gig at the Long Beach Arena in mid-1968. The Neil Young penned Mr. Soul from Buffalo Springfield's second LP, the unimaginatively titled Buffalo Springfield Again. By the time of the band's breakup, Young's profile had been raised considerably higher, and his reputation as a songwriter growing on a par to that of Joni Mitchell. She and Young now shared a manager after signing a deal with the Warner Brothers subsidiary, Reprise Records. Originally started by Frank Sinatra to control the release of his own music, the label had shifted its focus almost exclusively to rock, with artists like Jimi Hendrix, Frank Zappa, John Cale, and T-Rex. The transition into a solo career was far from smooth sailing. Young's self-titled debut suffered several issues, the most prominent of which was due to the use of the much-maligned Heiko CSG system. It was an analog device that was designed to make stereo records compatible with mono record players, but it often degraded the mix, so the album suffered very poor audio quality. Young, who has since become a firm advocate for audiophile values, was very disappointed with the results and intentionally buried his voice low in the mix. But musically, the album was an uneven affair, failing to push Young's style beyond the stylistic hallmarks of Buffalo Springfield, but yielding a few enduring live staples, such as The Loner.
He's a perfect stranger, like a cross of himself in a fox. He's a feeling arranger and a changer of the ways he talks.
the Loner from his debut album, which received a low-key response. His follow-up, Everybody Knows This Is Nowhere, fared much better. Young teamed up with Danny Whitten, Billy Talbot, and Ralph Molina to form the long-standing band Crazy Horse. He was in a frenzied rush of songwriting and penned the entire album in just 2 weeks. Several of the LP's most iconic songs, including Cinnamon Girl, Down by the River, and Cowgirl in the Sand, were written in a single day whilst Young was bedbound with a 103-degree fever. The album was a moderate chart success, but more importantly, redeemed Young with the critics, who praised his ability to portray melancholic emotions without resorting to irritating self-pity. Classic Cinnamon Girl from Neil Young's sophomore LP. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and on this episode of Classic Album Sundays Worldwide, I'm exploring Neil Young's third album, After the Gold Rush. By the time he started recording this LP, Young had caught the ear of many influential figures, not least his old bandmate Stephen Stills, who is now part of the Grammy-winning folk rock supergroup Crosby, Stills, and Nash. The band was keen to have Young on board as a sideman, but he was insistent that he be given a full title credit. Despite their success, he was a difficult presence within the band and at live engagements. For instance, during their performance at the 1969 Woodstock Festival, Young refused to appear throughout most of the set and warned the camera staff against putting him on film. Just like the Buffalo Springfield days, Stills frequently found himself fighting with Young for control over the band's songwriting, and has famously said that the latter wanted to play folk music in a rock band. But they managed to record a breathtaking album, 1970s Deja Vu.
There is a town in North Ontario, dream, comfort, memory, despair. And in my mind, I still need a place to go. shadows on our eyes leave us helpless, helpless, helpless.
Helpless,
hear me now. The chains are locked tight across the door.
Neil Young penned Helpless from the number one Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young album, Deja Vu. Whilst he was often difficult in interpersonal relationships with other band members, Young's dogged self-determination was a major artistic virtue that fed directly into what would become his first true solo masterpiece, After the Gold Rush. The album had its beginnings in an unlikely place. Actor Dean Stockwell had been encouraged by his friend Dennis Hopper to write a screenplay whilst the pair were in the jungles of Peru producing a film entitled The Last Movie. Hopper assured Stockwell that he had the relevant connections to get the film made, and once back in the U.S., Stockwell retreated to his home in Topanga Canyon in the Los Angeles Mountains and began writing. Neil Young was a fellow resident of the canyon and a close friend of Stockwell's. Young had been suffering a prolonged period of writer's block and was under growing pressure from his label to record an album of new material. He was intrigued with Stockwell's manuscript and asked if he could read a draft of the story. The now long-lost script was an unconventional, non-linear narrative with religious and psychedelic undertones. It loosely detailed an end-of-the-world scenario centered on the local Californian environment in which a biblical flood threatened to pull the state into the ocean. Captivated by this messy but intriguing tale, Young recalls, "I was writing a lot of songs at the time, and some of them seemed like they would fit right in with the story." Ironically, Hopper's proximity to the project scared off any interested executives, and before long, the film seemed destined to remain in limbo. Nonetheless, Young was fired up and undeterred and commenced work on what he imagined to be the soundtrack of this deeply countercultural Hollywood film. Finding time to write and record between Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young's huge U.S. tour and live obligations with Crazy Horse was difficult. And the precious gaps between shows, Young made initial recordings at Hollywood Sunset Studios, yielding I Believe in You and Oh Lonesome Me.
Are you here again? Finding that what you once thought was real is gone. Changing now. to you. At night I see my questions, I feel my doubts, wishing that maybe in a year or two we could laugh and let it all out.
Someone new.
Lonesome Me and I Believe in You from Neil Young's album After the Gold Rush. After attempting to record during stolen moments amidst touring, Young quickly realized he preferred the atmosphere of the canyon, continuing the process at the home studio setup in his lead-lined basement. It was here that his ensemble of bassist Greg Reeves, drummer Ralph Molina, and guitarist Niels Lofgren assembled. The studio was a small and sweaty space, adjoined to a side control room from which producer David Briggs kept an eye on proceedings. The youngest of the ensemble, 18-year-old Lofgren, was brought in to play keyboards despite being a relative novice at the time of recording, highlighting Young's unconventional, laid-back approach. Accordingly, the musician recalls that Neil didn't mind rehearsing a bit, but they didn't belabor stuff. It's often considered that Young was attempting to merge musicians from both Crosby, Stills, and Nash and Crazy Horse on this album, and Stephen Stills even appears on Only Love Can Break Your Heart to provide backing vocals. The basement's makeshift setup influenced the stark and plaintive sound of After the Gold Rush. Young featured solo on piano throughout the album, most notably on the title track, which is often praised as the centerpiece of the album. Charting a surreal and fantastical course through three verses, the song starts in a medieval era of knights and peasants and ends in outer space with the remnants of humanity after the world has descended into apocalypse. The song was designed to directly mirror the plot of the proposed film, and Young invited Stockwell to sit in on some of the album's sessions. The writer was impressed. If you could calculate the amount of human energy that goes into the making of one of his songs, you would have a really fucking high number, man. Explaining his thoughts behind the environmentally conscious song, Young recalls, "I recognize in it now this thread that goes through a lot of my songs, and that's this time travel thing. When I look out the window, the first thing that comes to my mind is the way this place looked 100 years ago."
Well, I dreamed I saw the knights in armor come and saying something about a queen. There were peasants singing and drummers drumming and the archers split the tree. There was a fanfare blowing to the sun that was floating on the breeze. On the run in the 1970s. Look at Mother Nature on the run in the 1970s. I was lying in a burned out basement with the full moon in my eyes. I was hoping for replacement when the sun burst through the sky. There was a band playing in my head and I felt like getting high. I was thinking about what a friend had said. I was hoping it was a lie. Thinking about what a friend had said, I was hoping it was a lie. Thank you. spaceships lying in the yellow haze of the sun. There were children crying and colors flying all around the chosen ones. All in a dream, all in a dream, the loading had begun. Flying Mother Nature's silver seed to a new home in the sun. Flying Mother Nature's silver seed to a new
Don't Let It Bring You Down, and the title track of Neil Young's After the Gold Rush, our Classic Album Sunday's Album of the Month. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and you're tuned in to Worldwide FM. Now, one of my favorite songs on the album is Southern Man, in which Young denounces the despicable racism directed against African Americans in the southern states. He describes the disparity between white plantation owners and their large mansions and the little shacks inhabited by blacks, and wonders when and how there will be amends for the fortunes that have been built upon the backs of slaves. It's thought that Southern rock band Lynyrd Skynyrd responded to Young's perceived attack on the South with a line in their hit Sweet Home Alabama, with the lines, "Well, I heard Mr. Young sing about her. Well, I heard old Neil put her down. Well, I hope Neil Young will remember. A Southern man don't need him around anyhow." But it was actually for another song of Young's entitled Alabama, and Young agreed that he was making condescending accusations against the state. However, there was camaraderie between the artists, and Young occasionally performed Sweet Home Alabama, and in turn, Lynyrd Skynyrd's Ronnie Van Zant took to wearing a Neil Young Tonight's the Night t-shirt at his gigs.
Southern man, better keep your head. Don't forget what your good book says. Southern change's gonna come at last. Now your crosses are burning fast.
Southern man.
After the Gold Rush, that's Neil Young with Southern Man, which became a mainstay on the new album-oriented rock radio format. However, Young also did break into the top 40 for the first time on this album with another song, and it was also a big hit for UK pop group Saint Etienne. The song? Only Love Can Break Your Heart. There was a professional and personal friendship between Young and David Crosby, Stephen Stills, Graham Nash, and Joni Mitchell. Graham and Mitchell had been in a serious relationship, living together in a house in Laurel Canyon In fact, it's the house of the Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young song, Our House. Graham wanted to marry Mitchell, but she refused because, as a woman of the 1960s, she didn't see how she could reconcile a domestic life with the creative, touring life of a musician. Nash documented the breakup in his song, I Used to Be King, on his debut solo album. And Mitchell, in turn, used the breakup as fuel for her album, Blue. And friend to them both, Neil Young penned his own lament.
Nestled in your wings, my little one,
is special. Morning brings another sun. Tomorrow, see the things that never come. Today, when you see me fly away without you, shadow on the things you know, feathers fall around you and show you the way to go. It's over. It's
Birds and the hit Only Love Can Break Your Heart from Neil Young and his third album, After the Gold Rush. The album as a whole fit neatly into Young's continued development as one of the finest songwriters of the North American tradition. His ability to convey nuanced emotion through potently simple chord sequences and unvarnished yet poetic lyrics is exemplified on songs such as Birds and Only Love, which highlight the often overlooked yet effortless sonic beauty of his music. The fact that the album allows such space for this aspect of Young's work to blossom reveals why it remains one of the most beloved in his expansive catalog. Despite not producing many hits, and even though it suffered a ferociously critical review from Rolling Stone, the album truly kicked off Young's celebrated solo career, preceding game-changing albums such as 1972's Harvest. It was also quickly reconsidered as one of the finest albums of the 1970s by the very publications who had tore it to pieces just a few years prior. It's a testament to how swiftly Young's career was ascending, from folk rock's resilient underdog to one of the standard bearers of the great American songbook. Before I close out the show, I want to remind you I'll be back next month when I'll celebrate Grace Jones' Trevor Horn-produced masterpiece, Slave to the Rhythm. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and thanks for listening.